On this Good Friday, we wait together at the foot of the cross. Jesus has been condemned to death by Pilate, and now we stand with the women who stayed by his side and waited for the inevitable.
There is a chain of silence that seems to lie so heavily with us in this night that is day.
In our brokenness, we have trouble remembering that we are the beloved children of God.
And so we look to the women gathered at the cross and their love for Jesus, a love that seems to be greater than their fears and strangely filled with faith.
Holy One, in this hour, help our love to be more like those who stayed, to be more like those who stayed at the cross. We pray this as people have prayed throughout the ages. O God, give us courage for the living of this day.
We invite you now to come forward and light a candle to signify the prayers and the attentions of your heart on this Good Friday.
Now, it was almost noon on preparation day for the Passover. Pilate said to the people, "Here is your king." "Take him away," they shouted. "Take him away, crucify him." Pilate asked, "Do you want me to crucify your king?" The chief priest said, "We have no king but Caesar." Then Pilate handed Jesus over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, carrying his own cross to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, along with two others, one on either side of Jesus. Standing close to Jesus' cross were his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing there, he said to his mother, "Here is your son," and then to his disciple, "Here is your mother." After this, Jesus knew that now all was completed. And to fulfill scripture perfectly, he said, "I'm thirsty." There was a jar of cheap wine nearby, so they put a sponge soaked in the wine on a hyssop stick and raised it to his lips. Jesus took the wine and said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave us his spirit.
Each year on this day, I ask myself the very same question. What is good about Good Friday? As a minister, I should know that answer. But I do not know that answer fully, although I know many who claim they do. One of the great joys of my life is to serve in a church that believes holy questions are more important than dogmatic answers. And to be able to stand here today in front of you and say, I don't know. And yet, every year on this day, I find myself realizing once again that this day is in fact good for so many reasons. And those reasons begin with a service like this, where we can sit together in sacred stillness in this sacred place, surrounded by the love of God. This year during Lent, we have lived with ashes and with prayers and with brokenness. On the table today, there are ashes that are the prayers that we wrote and prayed each Sunday during Lent. On the table today, there are broken pieces of pottery. We had a beautiful, large jar at the base of the chancel where we invited people each week during the Lenten services to place the prayers of their hearts that they had written. On the second Sunday of Lent, one of our deacons carrying the Bible and not realizing it hadn't been moved, that lovely jar, kicked it and it shattered. And my first thought was, where can I get another jar that looks just like that? But my wonderful assistant said to me, why don't you just use the jar broken and invite people to come and place their prayers in the brokenness? And so we did. The rest of the weeks, the prayers went into those broken pieces. Some of us like to live our lives believing that we are not broken. And we like to live our lives believing we will never be broken. But the story of this day tells us that we are all, in fact, broken. And that being broken is not the end of anything. Instead, being broken may just be the beginning. On this Good Friday, as we open our hearts, our minds, and our bodies to all that is in this time for us, may we open our lives to the God who walks with us on this day we call good.
A Blessing for This Day by Jan Richardson. Let us agree for now that we will not say the breaking makes us stronger, or that it is better to have this pain than to have done without this love. Let us promise we will not tell ourselves time will heal the wound when every day our waking opens it anew. Perhaps for now it can be enough to simply marvel at the mystery of how a heart so broken can go on beating, as if it were made for precisely this, as if it knows the only cure for love is more of it, as if it sees the heart's sole remedy for breaking is to love still, as if it trusts its own stubborn and persistent pulse is the rhythm of a blessing we cannot begin to fathom, but will save us nonetheless. Our Good Friday's offering and gifts will go to those in our community who need help to walk through their brokenness. Our offerings will now be given and received.
Thank you.
Today, a beautiful labyrinth has been prepared for you in the forecourt. And after the worship service, you are invited to stay and to walk that labyrinth. There will be individuals who will help you understand what to do and will give you a short devotional to read before you walk. The first time I walked a labyrinth was at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. It was a broken time in my life. And I remember walking into that massive cathedral and being so overwhelmed. It was the first time I'd been there. And I had no idea what a labyrinth was, nor how one was to walk it. But there were these dear people waiting to talk to me and to show me how this ancient practice could mean so much to me. I walked the labyrinth, and when I got into the center, I closed my eyes and stood there thinking, I should kneel. And I thought, that's ridiculous. Why would you do that? So instead, I just stood there for a few moments. And when I opened my eyes, the other people that were in the center of the labyrinth were all kneeling. There's something about a labyrinth that speaks to the deepest parts of us. So I encourage you, as you walk today, to listen to your heart, to listen to the Spirit. Let us pray. Holy One, how beautiful upon the horizon are the faces of people who announce hope, who proclaim that the dawn of a new day is coming swiftly to a world veiled in shadows. How beautiful upon the roads, O God, are the hands of those who embody peace, who touch with tenderness the wounds of a Savior and dress them with the healing waters of their tears. How beautiful upon the tables are the sounds of laughter of those who share their joy, who dare to celebrate the gift of life, even in the face of death, and who rejoice in the wonder of simple gifts. How beautiful upon the heart are the beats shared with those who know the sacredness of life, who are continually moved by their sacred, breathless moments, and whose very lives bless those around them. How beautiful upon the ages is a gift of love that came to us through the body of one whose vulnerable strength continues to transform the lives of all who accept the invitation to share. How beautiful upon the face of eternity is the God who comes to us, who dares to take on flesh and blood and live and die as one of us. How beautiful. As we leave today after the organ postlude, you will be invited to come and take a piece of the pottery with you to carry into these next hours until we meet again in this space on Sunday.